What's up, everyone? Welcome back to Let's Play Demon Souls. Still in 2-2, still doing post-commentary. I have gone back to the Nexus since the last episode to repair my weapon and make sure everything runs smoothly from here on out. My best efforts are for naught, though, because things will continue to not go quite so smoothly. I think we have at least like a 6-7 minute stretch before things get really bad again. I think I may get some graystone off the stone worms here. I generally love everything about Demon Souls and its level design in particular. 2-2, the first half of it is no exception. The second half is a fucking mess with samey looking narrow passages. It's like a claustrophobic maze set inside Oblivion's single tunnel. While bear bugs that shouldn't fit in these tunnels try to molest you, and then you exit into a lava pit where two bear bugs are just waiting to fuck my whole asshole up. And his friend behind him steps back in and spray paints "bear bugs were here" all over. And what do you get for trying to engage them and proceed forward? 30 minutes of your weapon ricocheting off the tight-ass walls, and the only way out into the open space is to fight these things. But their big-ass mandibles are plugging up the only way out there. After that, you spend the requisite 20 minutes running in circles, missing the exit like you're stuck in the on the Virginia Beltway, before finally giving up and committing suicide just to go back to the beginning so you can take the shortcut. It is horrible. But we want treasure and the full experience, so we'll put up with it. I really should have called the last episode the good half and this episode the bad half. Because I really, really hate the tunnels. Like I said, though, we have a few minutes before we get lost in the tunnels. For now, though, just trying to deal with the flying bear bugs here. The mosquito bear bugs. Because they can be a real pain in the ass if you're trying to fight them and the giant bear bugs down below in the lava pit. That's where they're flying up from, by the way. There's a big chasm below when we enter the tunnels that'll lead out into a gorge filled with lava. So I would rather, if I can, because their pathing is all messed up, deal with these guys now. Oh, also along this area, if you drop down a little bit from where Patches was, you'll notice that the filthy man, the vendor from 2-1, has reappeared there. Right above him, there's a drop down you can make, and you can get a dark heater shield +2 pre-upgraded. And I talked about upgrades in, I think, the episode before last, but I'm not sure how good of a job I did. It can be overwhelming getting your head around the upgrade system in Demon Souls, just because of how many different materials there are. There's three different varieties of the special ones, I'm gonna call them. And then there's four varieties of sharpstone and hardstone. So there's tons and tons of different types of stones. There are over, I think, 10 to 12 prefixes for items, all with different effects. There's the item scaling system that you have to be aware of, or I mean the attribute scaling. And then there's what items can be upgraded into what and what level they have to be at. Like, you have to have a short sword plus whatever to upgrade it to, you know, a crescent short sword. And all of that varies. So the best advice I can really give you, if you want to really wrap your head around it with more clarity, is to just look through the wiki, the upgrade page, for a bit. First, look at all the available upgrade paths, you know, crushing, tearing, crescent, and figure out which one suits your playstyle. Are you building magic? Consider crescent and moon items. Do you want fire damage for something, like if you're doing Valley of Defilement? Dragon is the way to go. Are you building a strength character? Go with crushing, because that has really good strength scaling. From there, you can click on the upgrade path on the wiki, and it'll tell you which basic weapons can be upgraded with that prefix and what basic upgrade level they have to be in order to get the prefix. So I have a pretty good idea of what I'm going to be using the upgrade stones, or I had, rather, I should be saying, as they became available. My initial plan was to just upgrade the Dragon Longsword and maybe use colorless Demon Souls to upgrade the Dragonbone Smasher and maybe the Dark Silver Shield. That quickly evolved to just doing every upgrade because you need a fully upgraded weapon of every prefix in order to get the Platinum Trophy. Now we have truly entered into the Mouth of Madness. This tunnel splits off over here and it merges in the same area. It just gives you a two different approaches to the bear bug up here. Keep wanting to call them bed bugs. Like, if we had gone right at the fork back there, it would have just curved around and led us over here. Now, because I am merciful, I am gonna go and speed up this giant bedbug and everyone after that. Because fuck watching that noise. If it's your first time playing through the game, I would also give you the advice of approaching your builds the same way as you approach upgrades, which is just to not worry about it too much. If it's your first playthrough, just put your points where you need them to use the items you want to use. You can mostly just freestyle it, just throw them in on the fly. Like if you get a new weapon that you want to use and you look at the requirements and it says you need, say 26 strength and you've already put like 6 or 7 points into strength, it's a no-brainer to just pop the extra ones in to use the item. Just figure out like what your favorite weapons scale with and pump that, and don't ignore vitality and endurance. And you can min-max if you want to, but there are so many options that you might drive yourself insane if you do that. And more fast-forwarding as I get lost in these goddamn tunnels. I hate the tunnels. I hate them so much. I don't have any good landmarks here. There are a few landmarks, but there aren't enough to keep me from getting lost in the tunnels. Like, I'm not normally the best navigator. I have a hard time visualizing maps in my head. So the tunnels, you might imagine, just exacerbate that problem to a ridiculous degree. What are these two guarding? Wait, there were two, right? What is this guy guarding? I think this is the one that's guarding the stupid augite of guidance. It's not really worth speeding this one up since this actually goes relatively quickly. And it's an actual fight, you know, complete with a whole movement and avoiding attacks and things. Rather than just plink, 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 nonstop. So, while that's going on, let's see. I want to see what this item is. I think it's the Augite. No, actually, it's a Stone of Ephemeral Eyes. Pretty good. There is a vendor, I'm not sure if all the vendors sell them. I know the vendor in 5-2 sells Stones of Ephemeral Eyes, which is really handy if you have a whole bunch of extra souls and you just need the stones for Black Tendency farming. I explained that in a later episode, so I won't go into why the Stones of Ephemeral Eyes are useful. If you come out here, this is very important. This is a spot that is important to find. From here, you can just leap down and make a couple drops, and you're pretty much right in front of Flamelurker's area, the boss. But there is a lot of treasure that we have not found in the tunnels yet, so that's what I'm going back for. In particular, I'm going back for one specific item. There is a pre-upgraded Dragon Longsword, I think it's a Dragon Longsword +1, somewhere down one of these pathways. And that is what I really want. There's also, if you go out into the yellow areas where you can see the yellow glow in the distance that leads out into the lava pits, where there are, I think, 3 or 4 giant bear bugs. One of the exits there, you have to fight 2 of them in a congested little tunnel where you can't get on their sides because, hey, they're plugging up the goddamn hole. There's a lot of dragon stones out there. There's a bunch of dragon stones in the lava out there. But. My flame resistance, I don't think, is high enough to tread on the lava for very long. With a full brushwood set and a brushwood shield and the ring of flame resistance and maybe some decent health, you can tread on the lava for a little bit and walk away with all the treasure without burning to death. I can't do that. Here is the stupid... Oh, god damn it. That one piece of loot. I hate it. Because you meander through these tunnels forever, just getting more and more lost, expecting some sort of good payoff. And then there's just that, which has no value whatsoever. I think you can trade one of them to Sparkly the Crow for something that's not intrinsically that valuable. But nothing that great. Like, nothing that makes it worth picking up. This one, this trap is annoying to try to trip. It's an annoying trap to trip. Luckily, the explosion radius isn't super high, so you can kind of just roll away on reaction without too much worry. Beware of trap ahead. I think that's if I was going the opposite direction. This, I think, is the path to the sword. Am I right, or am I... No, it's a fork. Nope. This is gonna, again, lead out into the lava pits. Ah, and we will soon be speeding up, because this is where I think the 2 giant bear bugs are that you fight at the same time. Is it? Am I right? No, I don't think I am. No, but there are some tiny ones. So, plink, 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 speed up, speed up. Fast forward. So, before I sat down to record this, I was reading an article that Chris Gray wrote on Gamasutra last month about the intended effect of randomness in games and how random drop systems are implemented and what their intended emotional effects are. I was reading that hoping that I could tie it into Demon's Souls somehow, and I realized something about Demon's Souls, is that Demon's Souls is very, very fair about everything, including the way its loot drops work. The way drops are typically implemented is that you farm and farm and farm, and you either get lucky or you don't, which means that some people are going to get a rare item, like first, second shot. An average who have put a decent amount of time into farming are going to get the item after, you know, their moderate amount of effort put into farming the item. And others who have put an insane amount of time in get that same drop, except with much more effort expended. But then that also means that there's going to be a smaller segment of the player population who, despite all of their time and effort, will never get that rare drop, regardless of how much they farm. It's just a matter of cruel, cruel probability. Gray also talked about 2 alternatives to that system. Escalating drops, meaning you increase the probability of a drop occurring each time it fails to drop until it becomes a guaranteed drop eventually, and the other being diminishing returns, which is just the opposite. You have a limited number of attempts to farm an item until the probability of you ever getting it hits 0. But that's essentially just as good to the segment of players in the traditional system, which wouldn't have seen the item drop anyway. Better for them because it spares them the frustration of wasting more time pursuing that item. There are 3 items in the entire game in Demon Souls that you cannot obtain reliably. What I mean by reliable is that the item is guaranteed either as a treasure somewhere or a predetermined drop from an enemy. You can acquire it as a guarantee during your playthrough, assuming that you're willing to put that effort in. If I want the Jade Hair Ornament, I'm always going to find it in the exact same place. I'll never have to farm for it. I'll never have to hope, will it drop this time? Will it be in this place this time? If I want a set of dull gold armor, there's always an NPC in 5-2. If you're in pure white world tendency and you kill her, she will always drop it. I think she drops it. If that's not the case, there's always a slug in 5-2 that you can kill and it will always drop that armor. There's nothing random about it. It's reliable. It's going to happen no matter what, as long as you kill that slug for the armor. If I want multiples of things, I might have to farm. Like, if I want enough stones to upgrade my Crescent Falcon +1 to +5, I might have to farm. But that's really one of the only situations. And there's the Dragon Longsword. That thing is sick. It does, I think, 91 damage is physical, yeah, and 91 is fire. It doesn't have any attribute scaling, but that's still a lot of damage. Especially just being at +1. So there are only 3 items that you cannot get on your first attempt reliably. There's pure Dark Moonstone, pure Moonlight Stone, and pure Blade Stone. They're all the pure versions of upgrade stones. Pure Dark Moonstone you can get off of lizards in 4-2 and 4-3, which means if you run out of lizard spawns in those levels, you're out of luck until New Game Plus, but the stones aren't insanely rare from them. Same goes for Moonlight Stones from the 3-2 and the 3-3 lizards. Lizards. I feel like I'm saying that weird. Blade Stone is the one everyone hates. Where Dark Moon and Moonlight Stones are commodities that you have to farm, they're at least closer to reliable. They're also examples of what Gray describes as diminishing returns on loot drops, because you have a limited number of spawns of crystal lizards, and after you exhaust those spawns, you no longer have a chance at those items. Unless you trade with other players online, and then everything that I'm saying goes out the window. But if we're just talking strictly farming, that's the case. Pure Bladestone is the one that really goes against Demon Souls' approach to loot. There are 2 monsters in the whole game that drop pure Bladestone. There's a Black Phantom dual katana skeleton, like the one that guards, guarded the Crescent Falcon in 4-1, except much more powerful because he is a Black Phantom. And he appears only in pure Black World Tendency in 4-2 near the end of the level. And there's a dual katana skeleton in a hidden passageway early in that same level. That's it. The only 2 enemies in the entire game who drop that item. And pure Bladestone, is a very rare drop. You can farm those 2 monsters for hours with a very high luck stat in pure Black World Tendency, which makes rare drops less rare, and you can come up dry. There are people who I've read on forums who have killed those 2 enemies 200 times and not gotten a pure Bladestone. It is the single item that turns the task of 100%ing Demon Souls from arduous to I want to tear my fucking hair out. And the only thing that really alleviates that frustration of having to farm for that is the online community. It's still thriving. You can still go on most Demon Souls subforums and set up a trade with someone. As long as you can provide something that someone wants, you can reliably get a pure Bladestone. You don't have to farm for it. And that's the only thing that really makes it tolerable. I probably would not be 100%ing this, if not for that fact. Because I farmed for about, let's see, I killed the hidden passageway black skeleton, I would say about 80 times without seeing a pure blade stone drop. And I had had enough by that point. But now we're coming up on Flamelurker's Fog Gate. So I wanted to talk about the item that I just got back there, the Hands of God. I'll save that until after the boss. I'll save that until between bosses, actually. For now, though, I'm just going to be silent as I approach the Fog Gate. I mean, I prepare my shit. Actually, yeah, let's just talk preparation real quick. So I have a catalyst, a ring of flame resistance, and a purple flame shield. The spell that I bought for this fight is called Water Veil. I think it reduces the amount of fire damage you take by a huge percent. It might be 90, but I could be wrong about that. There we go. Just want to stay silent for just a second, because Flamelurker's boss theme is tremendous. It's one of my favorites in the whole game. And in case you don't recognize it, you know the title card that I do, the Let's Play whatever that I do in the very beginning of a Let's Play, the first few seconds of the first episode? The song that's playing in the background of the title card for Demon's Souls was Flamelurker's boss theme, because it is the embodiment of you're fucked. Flamelurker's theme is perfect for this boss. It is the ultimate I made a mistake coming here music. The only thing that would set the mood of you're fucked more perfectly is if Patches escorted you to the Fog Gate, locked you inside Flamelurker's room, your character in the cutscene turns around and says, "You've made a serious mistake," and then the camera pans across his shoulder to reveal Flamelurker behind you going,
"Not as serious as yours."
Despite how poorly I did on this fight when I recorded it, oh man, I love this fight. This Flamelurker is significantly more aggressive than anything that you've come up against up until this point. So the fight should be a few minutes of me taking advantage of my openings properly and not constantly getting hit, but instead I kind of played like I was fresh off the lobotomy table. He also kind of put the fear of God into me on this playthrough, man. Because I had a few screw-ups and then I just started going, oh shit, to the point where instead of taking opportunities when he was open to attack, I just backed off like, hey man, don't want any trouble, okay? It's like, the mistakes started to compound themselves, and I hesitated a lot. Not to be too hyperbolic, but this is the worst Flamelurker fight I've ever had. And I got flustered while doing this. I didn't dodge anything. I blocked way too much. The thing about Flamelurker is that he isn't that hard once you adjust to him, because like I said, he's significantly more aggressive than anything you face up until this point in the game. And he's also way more damaging. He's actually, he's probably the most aggressive boss in the whole game. Penetrator has streaks where he can be pretty all over you and not give you much breathing room, but not like Flamelurker. And the other bosses people consider to be fairly tough, they actually give you a lot of breathing room. False King and Maneaters, specifically. they give you a lot of time to collect yourself and recover. Flamelurker, he has little brief periods like this where he backs off for just a few moments, long enough for you to maybe eat one or two pieces of grass, not enough to really do much else. They're just little saving grace periods. And even so, the other hard bosses can still be, I feel at least, managed a lot easier. Flamelurker is just aggressive. You can't do much except respond to him. And if you do that poorly, you just constantly take damage. It is a really fun fight, though. But when you're off, it just feels like you're getting walked all over, like you're getting stomped into the ground. He also has a deceptive range on the explosive punch attack. He has two different, like, explosive attacks. He has the charged up one, which is just an AoE around him, and the one where he punches forward that one, and it causes a frontal cone explosion. The explosive punch is the one that I am having trouble with on this fight, because the idea is that the optimal way to approach this fight would be to actually get right up in his face, and whenever he telegraphs that explosive punch, you roll to the side and behind him. I'm playing too much of a what would be the word? A hesitant game with him, and I just accidentally unequipped my shield while trying to cast Water Veil. I'm playing too hesitantly, and I'm relying way more than I should on blocking his attacks rather than avoiding them. Because if you're at a mid-range against him and you try to roll away, then the best case scenario is that you just avoid the damage if you react quick enough. It doesn't give you enough time to counterattack, usually without leaving yourself open to Flamelurker's own counterattacks. If you play at that mid-distance and you try to roll to the side to avoid the attack, then you usually end up just taking damage, which is one of my big problems so far in this fight. If you play right up against him, though, if you're hugging him, you can roll around him pretty easily. It's way more reliable to get around the damage, and it gives you a better opening to counterattack and then prepare for his aggression. The reason it's not a good idea to try to block everything he does, especially in your first playthrough when you have lower stamina, he chews through your stamina. He has very high damage attacks that can just eat through it, like right there, and he attacks before you can fully recover. Like, Armored Spider had a few attacks that drained a lot of stamina when blocked, but Armored Spider attacked so slowly and infrequently that you recover all your stamina in time for the next attack anyway, so it didn't matter. And Flamelurker attacks much more aggressively than that. That's why it's better to dodge in this fight than it is to block. That's why you have to have a really good sense of his attack patterns and what he's telegraphing. And even if you have good flame resist, he's still doing fire damage that's going past your shield. Small little bits that are chipping away. And then once he puts you on the back foot, once he chips away enough to where you have to back up and heal, that's where things really start to go downhill. My fight here is a tutorial on how not to approach this boss. You can prepare all you want. Flamelurker is the first fight in the game you're likely to come across that does not give a fuck about how much you prepare. If you aren't playing well enough, he's gonna wreck you and make your preparations absolutely worthless. The thing I kind of kept getting caught off guard by, aside from just the range and the hesitation, was mistiming the dodge on that explosive punch. Because I was not only playing from a bad range, I was also not timing my rolls too well. I mean, ideally, I could have gotten through even in the shitty positioning with just the invisibility frames, but yeah. that wasn't happening. He also breaks your guard pretty often and makes you vulnerable long enough to do really, really massive hits. Bad, bad Flamelurker fight. It's okay, though. The other thing is, I was really worried. It almost would have been better if I had come into this fight at 75% health with the Cling Ring on and in soul form, because then I wouldn't have been worried about my world tendency shifting. Part of the problem is I was really worried about dying on this fight. Ironically, the thing that almost got me killed, I was worried about dying in body form and having my world tendency shift towards black. And that's because the very next level, the Dragon God, there's an item that you can only get once per game, and you can only get it, I think, if you enter Dragon God's lair in pure white world tendency, or if killing Dragon God would net you pure white. Otherwise, you can't get the item. So I was really worried about making sure that I could get it. And sometimes the fear of losing detriments your playstyle to the point where you cause yourself to lose. Ideally, you should play just as well at 1 HP as you do at 100%, only adjusting the things that are hurting you, or only adjusting your strategy for the things that hurt you. That's one of the things that separates people who are really good at fighting games from, you know, more mid-tier players. They play consistently well no matter what their health bar is. When you get people who are worse at fighting games, they tend to get really, really defensive once they're low on health. But for now, we have entered the Dragon God's lair. The boss who killed us all that time ago in the scripted tutorial section, the Dragon Bone Smasher, is the item I was talking about that you can only get in pure white world tendency here. See, it's right there in the beginning of the level. You're mostly safe while going to get it. On rare occasions, though, Dragon God can just punch you on your way over to the debris that you have to clear out on the way to it. The way Dragon God works is he's commonly referred to as a gimmick boss. As badass as he looks, we don't really do much direct fighting against him. He's more puzzle than he is a straight boss fight, or at least what we're used to from boss fights from Demon Souls. So you see him scanning the area for us with those glowing yellow eyes. When you expose yourself, Dragon God sees you and his eyes turn red, indicating that he knows where you are. And he'll either do a flame breath attack or he'll punch the wall around you, and it'll do a lot of damage. So you can hide behind these safe spot pillars where he can't see you. And the goal is to dash out, clear the debris in your way, and then dash back to a safe spot until you reach one of two arrow contraptions. I think they're ballistas? And there are... is one here, and there's one on the opposite side after we fire this one. So once you fire the first harpoon, you shave off about 40% of Dragon God's health, and he punches a pathway open. He opens a pathway for you by punching the wall and clearing the arrow contraption out. And I think that's a Stone of Ephemeral Eyes right there. This gives you a good chance to just heal up. If you come in here with low stamina, Dragon God will usually one-shot you. I have a little bit higher stamina than normal, so I'm surviving single hits. It is a really easy fight, but sometimes you can just get caught in what feels a little random. Sometimes he'll just fail to notice you when you dart out, which is the ideal scenario here. With heavy weapons, two-handed, most of that debris gets cleared out in a single swing, but it's a much slower swing. It's just you risk darting out into Dragon God's line of sight fewer times. It's a bit of a dice roll. So it's just a bit of a waiting game. It's not even a terribly complicated puzzle. I think that's what makes this fight less enjoyable than it could be, even as a gimmick fight. Because if the gimmick was more engaging, that would obviously be ideal. There is a fight that's just like this, except I think less fun, less interesting. In Dark Souls, it's a boss known as the Bed of Chaos, and it functions in a pretty similar way to this. So while I'm clearing debris out, I want to talk about the item I got right before Flamelurker's Fog Gate. There were two fist weapons called the Hands of God. And if you read the item description, they say that they were the former property of a man named Big M, who killed dragons with his bare fists. And I think that might be referring to Ed, because there's a line that Baldwin says back in the Nexus, I think we heard it a few episodes ago, where he's talking about how he was tossing the bear bugs off the cliff, and how he was talking about how people expected him to just go and beat the bear bugs barehanded. And then he talks about how Ed, the other blacksmith, is even stronger than him. So there's some speculation that maybe Big M is actually referring to Ed, and Ed is going around just punching the shit out of dragons? Makes for a very badass backstory for that man. But there's nothing concrete that points to who Big M is. There's a lot about the lore in Stonefang in particular that feels incomplete. Like, Demon Souls' story is generally a game of connect the dots with a lot of dots. But even here in Stonefang, it feels more sparse than in other levels. Like, you have fewer things to connect to form a complete vision of what's going on here. We know that there are the scale miners who once worshipped the dragon god, who built this shrine to him, who also imprisoned him here and presumably built the arrow contraptions to keep him under control if the need ever arose to kill their god. We know Flamelurker existed long, long ago. At least long before the Old One awakened this time. We don't know if he was a creation of the Old One's previous awakenings, but he is ancient. There's also a little bit of speculation that the fire of Flamelurker gave birth to smithing. And that speculation is mainly centered around the fact that you use Flamelurker's soul, the Red Hot Demon Soul. You give that to Blacksmith Ed in 2-1. And he can use that fiery soul to forge new unique weapons out of other demon souls. You can combine other demon souls with weapons to create new weapons once you give the Flamelurker's soul to Ed. And this is the finale to the fight. We just come over here and give Dragon God a few taps on the teeth with our dinky little sword. And that the fire that he's breathing out, that it can actually damage you. You stand no real chance of dying at this point. I've never heard of anyone dying to Dragon God once they get both harpoons into him and bring him down. It's almost sad in a way. It's like, I don't know, it's like watching a whale get harpooned. This noble, majestic dragon god. It's okay, though. He won his soul. His soul, I think, can be used in three different things. I think it buys the Wrath of God miracle, the Firestorm miracle, both of which are the strongest AoE offensive spells in the game. And there is a fireball attack that we can get from him, or from his soul. I think if you jump down here, there is a legendary soldier soul, yes. And there's also some other items lying around. I think there are some other souls. And you're free to explore the tiny little area once Dragon God is dead. And it's a pretty straightforward, kind of linear area. So it's not like there's too much hidden around. You just have to backtrack through all of it. Anyway, though, now that Dragon God is dead and I have done my first 40... Yeah, wow. This is the first 40-minute episode that is not a finale of a regular Let's Play. Anyway, there was the hour-long Ni No Kuni first hour video. But anyway, gonna cut the episode here. We will pick up tomorrow with, let's see, the first level of the Tower of Latria. Until then, though, if you like the episodes, be sure to subscribe, comment, hit the like button. It's all right there. Till next time, though, take it easy, guys. Have a good one.